We've identified a new asbestos-related disease, and we're figuring out ways to avoid it.
Her story lives on in each and every one of you.
Firefighters that have lost their lives, that have really put everything on the line.
I would like to thank the ADAO for invitation and the honor which has been granted to me. In fact, I cannot take it totally to myself. I have to share it with all the staff members of Finnish Institute of Occupational Health, who have done so much work for asbestos-related diseases during the decades. And one of those staff members is here, Suvi Lehtinen, sitting there. She's vice president of AIKO also now. She has been working very much for getting asbestos issue in publicity, and she has also organized a lot of international meetings on asbestos in different continents. So it is not only for me, I take it also for my staff and my colleagues and my institution. But thank you. Anyway, it's a great honor also for Finland. I was asked to discuss the recent developments in diagnosis and attribution of occupational asbestos-related diseases, which is an important issue, and this morning discussions have even more amplified the need to do proper diagnosis and most of all early diagnosis, because most of the asbestos-related diseases are still diagnosed in relatively advanced stage of the disease, which eliminates the possibilities in many cases for at least secondary and tertiary prevention of diseases. In fact, the asbestos is no new thing. It has a very long history, and unfortunately, it has also a long future ahead. And this is a history is important, but future probably more important. And the future of asbestos is long. We can expect that already, and I will show some data on that. In Finland, we have more than 4,000 year old archaeological findings on asbestos, which is due to the extremely rich concentration of asbestos in partly eastern Finnish ground. So some experts sometimes have proposed total elimination of asbestos from the world, but I think at least in eastern Finland and in Libby, we cannot even dream about that. We have to live it with it, but we have to protect the people and not take it into use anymore. But still we have a problem on asbestos, in the case we do all that. I have made some very rough and inaccurate calculations on total amount of asbestos produced in the world since year 1900, something like 120 years ago, which has been the most active period of using asbestos in the industrialized world mainly. It amounts to about 200 million tons. And production still continues at the level of about 2 million tons a year, which is a problem. And unfortunately, that asbestos mainly is coming from Europe. Russia is the biggest producer. We got also from Dr. Frank from Asia, and we have some other countries like Brazil and Zimbabwe who will still produce. Of course, Canada is most interesting because it has happened very interesting developments in Canada. And I would like to call your attention to the recent Canadian report on difference in asbestos-related cancers in Quebec and in rest of Canada, which is very interesting and educational paper. Please consult that. It is in under American Journal of Industrial Medicine published there. So 55 countries so far have banned asbestos. One of the most important achievements in that was that EU, as an whole EU community did ban asbestos. Not that early, it needed a lot of stimulus from our Nordic community side, but finally we got it. And that now means that 28 countries in Europe and Western Europe and Central Europe are banners, which is very important development in Europe. We have recently published, together with Japanese colleagues, the estimation of European cancer, partly mesothelioma statistics, and we, in that paper, found very clear signs of severe under-registration, under-diagnosis, underestimation of the risks, and the reason is eastern part of Europe, including Russia and many other countries there in the eastern part. And the rough calculation was Professor Takahashi had done earlier that we have about 20% underdiagnosis of mesothelioma. Now I think we may need to change that and elevate that estimation of underdiagnosis, which might be very substantial. The global asbestos story is not going to end, as I said. Those countries which have banned asbestos early, they will see still asbestos-related diseases in 2060. We saw a nice graph from UK. It ended with 2030, but it's going to continue after that still. It was not at all at zero in 2030. In Nordic countries, the same. Those early banners start to show leveling off of the curves, not really very reliable decline of the curves, but leveling off anyway, particularly in the mesothelioma. But those countries which have not banned, they see growing rates. And that is the problem, because big populations, as Dr. Frank was telling, Asia is the biggest population in the world, and they are still using actively, and their curves are going to grow rapidly. So those who have not banned will see asbestos-related diseases, according to our very, let's say, rough estimates, still in the year 2100. So asbestos story is not at the end. The present occurrence of asbestos epidemic has been estimated by several authors. I refer only to limited numbers of, but what is probably the most reliable one is the WHO 2010 estimate. I have a spelling error, 10 is missing. It is 107,000 cancers a year, or asbestos-related mortality per year, and 97,000 are mesotheliomas. This immediately starts to tell us that we have underreporting and underestimation, because lung cancers are, it was just discussed, and they are at least twice as common. In Finnish statistics, we register three times more lung cancers than mesotheliomas. And there are estimates in some from some countries that there's sixfold rates for lung cancers compared to the mesothelioma rates. So that alone is already a sign of under-reporting and underestimation of risks. Dr. Driscoll did very interesting data. He's Australian top expert in asbestos. He calculated DALIs of asbestos. Most of you know what is DALI. It is disease-adjusted life year lost because of asbestos. He ended up with 1.6 million DALIs a year related to asbestos. To put it in other words, it means that asbestos fatalities will shorten the life years with 1 year for 1.6 million people. So that's another way to express the same data. And I would like to emphasize it's only 1 year accumulation of mortality. So it is really a big epidemic corresponding and approaching the limits, the size of the other public health epidemics like polio, like tuberculosis and so on. It's no minor epidemic in the world. We can calculate the occurrence of asbestos diseases also on other bases, which is very rough and very inaccurate, but I will anyway take the risk to present, because even those register-based data which WHO has used and Dr. Driscoll has used, they are not very reliable. Even the case, the methodologies are very good, because only 50%, a little bit less than 50% of countries of the world have well-organized cancer registries, population-based cancer registries. So half of the countries don't register cancers. Therefore, it is very difficult to really estimate the part of their proportion of the, or their share of the diseases. If we do that kind of calculation on the basis of Professor Takahashi's data, I think he has presented this same data in your meeting earlier, it is a little bit difficult again to estimate, because low consumers and high consumers have different risks of asbestos, even per capita. And also the time period when it has been consumed has an impact on the rate. I took a risk to put the, as we used to say, church in the middle of the village. So I took some kind of very rough average of number of mesotheliomas per tons of asbestos, and I used one mesothelioma per 200 tons of asbestos, which is not the lowest range, but not even the highest, but it is something between these. And I would like to warn, this is very inaccurate, but just looking at the situation, if we can base it this way, and this is the curve which is very reliable, showing that that asbestos consumption has really linear impact on the occurrence of cancers. And then I took another assumption on the basis of Finnish data, putting three lung cancers per one mesothelioma. And that way we end up with the total loss of lives since year 1900 to be something between 1 million, which is the lowest minimum estimate, and 5.6 million, which is the maximum estimate. The Finnish population is now 5.3 million. It means that if this mortality was concentrating only in Finland, the whole nation had died. So that is the size, if we can use this way of calculation. Trends are growing. These are many, many, many countries here registered who have cancer registries, and both lung cancers and mesotheliomas are growing. There are differences in rate of growth depending on when you ban it and how did you use the asbestos and what kind of asbestos you were using. But the trend is growing, and as I said, the leveling off can not really be seen in most of the countries. Some countries can show it. Finland is one of those, which Sweden also, which can show some leveling off now. Okay, that was the reason why we already in 1995 started to think that we should recognize better asbestos-related diseases in order to help the global communities to deal with the problems. And the first thing to deal with the problem is to recognize the diseases. So therefore, it was very, very badly needed. In 97, we published the Helsinki criteria for attribution and diagnosis of asbestos-related diseases, which was very well taken by the by countries. We had a very big group of 18 leading asbestos researchers who had published collectively more than 1,000 research articles on asbestos. So it was a very, very heavy group scientifically participating. And some of the members are here. Now we decided after 18 years that we should look again, because research has made some progress, and we should update the criteria. And it was 2-year work divided in special groups, expert groups. Dr. Milan was one of those group members looking at the new asbestos-related diseases. And we worked very hard in order to get the new knowledge in our use, and it was really very informative and educational work for all of us. I will describe briefly what this Helsinki criteria 2014 is containing, but unfortunately I cannot go to the diagnostic criteria of individual diseases, because we had 8 different disease entities, so time doesn't permit it. But why these criteria were generated, it is first probably important issue. And of course, the growing trends are one of the reasons why we thought they are needed. Secondly, we have poor coverage of those registries, as was mentioned. Therefore, we would improve the registration and notification and even compensation better. And it needs reliable diagnosis, otherwise it is not possible. We have also quite a prevalent unawareness. Sometimes we are surprised, because we who are working in the field, we think it is already an old stuff, we really know everything about that. But it's surprising how little is known by the world on asbestos-related risks, and therefore organizations who are doing advocacy for asbestos are extremely important, like Linda's organization has shown. We don't have also really very strong stimuli for prevention. So we should get them registered so that we really can stimulate preventive activities and even regulatory activities. The first point in criteria is who is asbestos exposed, because the exposure, identification of exposure, is the prerequisite for diagnosis of asbestos-related, particularly in the lung cancer case. Mesothelioma is some way indicator diagnosis for asbestos, but lung cancer, for instance, is not. We concluded after very, very thorough analysis of research that still working history is the most important indicator of asbestos exposure, but it should be done carefully and competently, so that you have well-structured questionnaires to do that and well-trained interviewers. I can tell from Finland that when we trained our pulmonology clinics to do asbestos anamnesis, the rates of our asbestos-related diseases were rocketing quickly up, as the clinical world was not so well aware of asbestos-related diseases, even not the lung clinics, which were probably the most knowledgeable about that. So cumulative asbestos fiber counts are, of course, important, but not absolutely necessary to conclusion on asbestos exposure. So absence of that data doesn't justify that the asbestos exposure has not happened. The same with the tissue fiber counts, which is very good and useful, but seldom available. And some types of asbestos, like chrysotile, is disappearing, and therefore it is not really the very, very reliable sign of exposure. But of course, if it does exist, it is good. And the same is also the counting of asbestos bodies. It's good information and partly for clinical purposes, but not absolute indication. The absence doesn't really tell absolutely that asbestos exposure has not happened. That was about the exposure. We have diseases considered in criteria asbestosis, ventilatory impairment, which had also some new information, pleural disorders, very important one, as was discussed by Lippi panel also, mesothelioma, several types of mesothelioma, a couple of new types, histological types of mesothelioma, lung cancer, again, several types of lung cancer, which were considered and discussed, laryngeal cancer, ovarian cancer, and retroperitoneal fibrosis. These were eight diseases we covered in the criteria. And these three latter ones, larynx, ovary, and retroperitoneal fibrosis, are new. They were not included in the 97 criteria. We discussed also truly the stomach cancer and colorectal cancer. In colorectal cancer, the data didn't yet permit to make the conclusion and attribution for asbestos, but I think we are very close to that. So research should be continued in order to get better evidence. And this is extremely important if colon cancer is asbestos related, because it is so common and is growing. And therefore, if it is elevated even a little bit, it means a lot of cases, like in the case of lung cancer as well, as they are so common. So this has important public health impact if it is asbestos related. As in general, we use twofold increased risk of asbestos-exposed workers compared to the non-exposed as a sign of asbestos-related cancer. But we also concluded that between 1 and 2, there are many cases which should be also considered. So that as a medical people, we should start looking at everything which is above 1. So that is a public health principle we should take into consideration. The diagnosis has been described for each of the diseases, definition of the disease, causes and attribution, requirements for exposure, duration, quality and type of exposure, subtypes of disease, as I mentioned, lung cancer and mesothelioma have some new subtypes, key diagnosis tools and criteria also described, and conclusions and feedback, conclusions on diagnosis, and then, let's say, summary of everything is included. In key diagnostic methods, we, of course, partly in the case of lung cancer, also partly fibrosis and pleural diseases, discussed very intensively the first, the chest X-ray, conventional chest X-ray, and then high-resolution, low-dose CT. And we were very reluctant to recommend any more chest X-ray, conventional chest X-ray, because of the radiation dose and insensitivity in diagnosis. What we also discussed was the screening of lung cancer, which is a hot issue, and not only because of asbestos, but also because of tobacco. And we had an excellent expert from National Lung Cancer Screening Study to help us in taking all the lessons from your national project. And we proposed, two groups to be elected to screening of asbestos-related workers. We took those who meet the National Lung Cancer Screening Study criteria, and also workers with asbestos exposure with or without smoking, but otherwise the risk level should be something like National Lung Cancer Study criteria where, or risk levels were. There was discussion whether this is appropriate to subordinate asbestos cases to the heavy smokers cases in National Lung Cancer Study. And I think we are going to discuss this further and continue this discussion, because my personal opinion is that we should keep asbestos cases as an independent entity and look at their risk and choose the patients to screening without having condition of heavy smokers entry criteria. Okay, so some different opinions are also prevailing, so we will see what happens in the future. What is important that the screening should use methods which are effective and safe. So we should not go too, let's say, uncritically to do the, for instance, a conventional X-ray may be probably no more recommendable. We should also continue screening and follow up long enough. In fact, we proposed that at least 30 years from the cessation of exposure should be used for conventional type of follow-up of the workers. Whatever was the methodology, it may develop in the time, but anyway, we should use it for long times. Best possible care was also warranted by the group, so that the asbestos patients are treated, in fact, as a kind of a vulnerable group, and they are going to get the best care. In fact, what we discussed, immunization against pneumococcus and influenza, are fully recommended for care. Of course, now we have learned this morning how much new opportunities are provided by research. We should try to take them in active use as soon as possible. We didn't discuss compensation, but compensation is one consequence of reliable diagnosis, and we should also think about that all the time. And in fact, in Nordic countries, we have made a solution that we have generated special funds which are compensating asbestos-related diseases, so it doesn't lead to court cases, and there is a relatively fair compensation for the patients. And I think that would be recommended for others, because it is totally unreasonable that the poor patient needs to start court lawsuit against the employer or producer in order to get fully justified compensation. Finally, this is the slide I have to skip, but I just want to say that it is extremely important to look at the hierarchy of prevention, starting from the most primary prevention, which we call structural prevention, which is the elimination of asbestos use and banning, total banning. Secondly, we have to look at the demolition workers who are exposed still for years and protect them as effectively as possible. Also, secondary prevention with the protectors is important, and we have a USA and for the health and safety executive in England have extremely good guidelines for demolition workers protection. And then we have to look also at the health surveillance and diagnostics, because cases are going to be, as I showed in the beginning. Finally, I would like to answer the question which also Linda asked me, what should we do as a next step? I think we should, of course, continue these exercises for better diagnosis, better identification, better registration, and make use of research always when it is available, and we are very happy that we get new hope from the research. But at the national level, I would propose three-tier strategy. First, total ban, which is the long-term solution. The impact is delayed, even the case we ban today. Then identification of existing sources of the asbestos which is in our facilities and buildings and industries, removing it carefully and protecting our workers there very well. It is very important. It has a medium-term impact in asbestos-related diseases. And then identification and diagnosis or good recognition of diseases and existing cases. And this has a short-term impact if we do it immediately. So these are the three tiers which would be seen in every country in national asbestos programs. Of course, registration of exposed workers is extremely important, and it is not very well developed. We should get that, because otherwise we are always searching the cases and we don't know who is exposed, who is not. And finally, this is not only health sector story. This is concerning several sectors of the society. In fact, we in our asbestos committee did proposals for 8 different jurisdictions, including industry, including defense, education, hospital sectors, and so on. And this is very typical example of health in all policies, as WHO nowadays wants to emphasize. Finally, I would like to say that for us, medical people and health people, prevention, good care of the and careful protection of demolition workers, earliest possible diagnosis, and effective use of all the preventive and secondary preventive possibilities we have. It is our both medical and ethical imperative. Thank you very much indeed.